Well, good morning and welcome to Open Door Online. I'm Pastor Andy and wanted to welcome you personally to our services today. We have an exciting service planned for you and can't wait to get into a time of worship in just a moment. But I wanted to personally welcome you and thank you so much for choosing to worship with us online at Open Door today. If you're a first-time guest, would you please take your phone out right now and text the word new to the number that's on your screen. We'd like to send you a gift through the mail. So if you would do that real quick for us, we can get that gift to you. It's not just a coffee mug that you're going to put in the cabinet and it's going to collect dust and you're going to forget about it. This is a good gift and you're really going to want it. So we want to send that to you. And after all, who doesn't want a gift? So we want to send that to you through the mail this week. So if you would, take your phone out right now. Go ahead and do it so you don't forget about it. Text the word new to the number that's on your screen so that we can get that mailed out to you. We do want to welcome all of you to our service today. I'm so excited about what the Lord's doing at Open Door, and especially about what He's laid on my heart to share with you today. So we're going to jump right into the service this morning. I hope you enjoy. I hope you have a great day. God bless you, and I'll see you in a minute.
So stand to your feet. We've got another great service planned for today. We're going to start off by singing praises to our God, who is indeed worthy of every song that we sing. In every breath that we breathe. Amen.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
Yes, amen. Awesome stuff. Please join me in a word of prayer. We'll get this service started. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity once again to come into this place and gather in your name wherever we're at, God. We thank you for everything that you've done in our lives, God. For the fact that we're all here right now just shows us that you're not done with us yet, God. So continue to fill us with what we need. Be over this service today, God. Thank you for Andy's leadership. Continue to use him and feed him spiritually so he can do his work throughout this congregation, and that we can do that. God, I thank you for all of our ministries and our ministry leaders so that they can continue to do that. God, we are so thankful that you use cracked vessels for your work, because we all fall short of your glory. Help us grow, God. Give all of us what we need today so that none of us would leave here the same way we came. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen, amen. We are so excited. We get to teach you guys a new song today, and it's a song that I can almost guarantee that as you are going through your week, it's going to keep popping back up in your head. And as you go through these different trials that you're going to experience through the week, because the Bible doesn't say if we go through trials, it says when we go through trials, so we know they're coming. So you can take this song and you can apply it to all of those things, all right? All right, just follow along with us, and I know you'll quickly pick it up. Clap your hands like this. Here we go.
Miracles when you move, such an easy thing for you to do. And your hand is moving right now. You are still showing up at the tomb of every Lazarus. And your voice is calling me out. And never lost a battle, and I know you never will.
Woo! Is he good, God, to you guys today? Come on, let's keep singing. Let's go.
Everything's possible by the power of the Holy Ghost. A new wind is blowing right now. Breaking my heart of stone, taking over like it's Jericho, and my walls are all crashing down. And right now, I know you're able.
You never lost a battle.
You never lost a battle.
You never lost. lost a battle.
Never lost a
and
battle.
You never will.
No, you never will.
Said you never lost a battle.
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 And you never will.
Oh, you never will.
Said you never lost a battle.
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 And you never will. Said you never lost a battle.
Never lost a battle.
No, you never lost a battle.
You never lost a battle.
You never lost a battle. 'Cause you can do all.
You can do all things.
Yes, you can, Lord.
You
I know you can,
do
Lord.
All things but fail. 'Cause you never lost a battle
today.
No, you never lost a battle.
And I know
you never will.
Come on, you guys got this.
'Cause you can do all things.
Yes, you can, Lord.
You can do all things but fail. 'Cause you never lost a battle. No, you never lost a battle.
And I know
you never will.
The greatest thing about this next song, I think, is because it relates to everybody from one extreme to the other. Whether just having a tough day, or maybe you're at some really heavy challenges in your life and some heavy burdens and chains. And every example in between, you know, there's a reason why this guy just got Songwriter of the Year. So just good stuff. There was Jesus. Amen. Every time I try to make it on my own, every time I try to stand and start to fall, for all those lonely roads that I've traveled on, there was Jesus. When the life I built came crashing to the ground, when the friends I had were nowhere to be found, I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now. There was Jesus. Sing this out, church. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing and the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken. Every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it, there was Jesus. For this man who needs amazing kind of forgiveness at a price I couldn't pay. I'm not perfect, so I thank God every day. There was Jesus.
In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing and the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken. Every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it,
there was Jesus on the mountain, in the valleys,
there was Jesus
in the shadows of the alleys,
there was Jesus.
in the fire, in the blood. Always is and always was. Every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it, there was Jesus. There was Jesus.
Amen.
If all I had was Christ, I'd have nothing to gain. If all I have is Christ, and I have everything. His presence is enough. He hides me in His wings. He wraps me in His love. He stirs my heart to sing. My life is in His hands. He is my confidence. He keeps His promises forever and amen. He is gentle with my heart. He knows each tear I cry. There's healing in His scars for every one of mine. My life is in His hands. He is my confidence. He keeps His promises forever and amen. I have never known a love like this before.
Promises forever and amen.
guys. I'm Pastor Andy, and I want to welcome each one of you to our service this morning. If you're a first-time guest watching at home, man, you are our honored guest. We really appreciate you taking the time and spending with us this morning, and I hope you've enjoyed the service. If you would, right now, take your phone out and text NEW to the number that's on your screen. The reason I want you to do that for us is because we have a gift that we would like to send to you. Who doesn't like gifts? I mean, and this is a good gift. This isn't one of those coffee mugs you're going to put up in the cabinet and never look at again and never use. This is a gift you're going to use. You're going to really enjoy it. So if you would, take your phone out real quick. Text the word NEW to the number that's on your screen, and we'll get that mailed out to you this week. But we appreciate you joining with us. If you call Open Door your church home, or you've been attending or watching online, we thank you so much for your faithfulness. And we're excited about what the Lord's put on my heart this morning to share with you. We're continuing in our story of David, and we're looking at his life. And we've had a phenomenal few weeks looking at the life of David, seeing how he faced Goliath and all the things. And in fact, last week we had another great service. We had two adults who trusted Christ, and we had several first-time guests, and we had a membership class this week. So we do one of those every month, and if you'd like more information on that, you can check us out on the website and sign up for that class and be a part of it. We'd love to have you join us with that. But in our study of David, I mean, David is a special character in God's Word. He's mentioned over 1,127 times. I mean, there are 54 chapters dedicated just to the life of this one man. That's more than anybody else in God's Word. God really put an emphasis on the life of this guy. I mean, after all, he's known in God's Word, and God calls him a man after God's own heart. What an awesome way to be known, and that's the way David was known. And as we continue looking at his life, there's an awesome gift that I want us to see today that God gives to each one of us. It's a special gift from God that he gives to all of us, and it's called the gift of friendship. Friendship. We don't normally think of friends as gifts, but I think after we're done today, you're going to see that friends, real friends, are a gift from God. They say that if you're a fortunate man, you can count the number of friends you have on one hand. And if you fill that hand up, you're a very blessed man. It's important for us to have good friends, but it's even more important for us to be a good friend. The Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter 18, after David had finished talking with Saul, he met Jonathan, the king's son. There was an immediate bond between them, for Jonathan loved David. From that day on, Saul kept David with him and wouldn't let him return home. And Jonathan made a solemn pact with David because he loved him as he loved himself. Jonathan sealed the pact by taking off his robe and giving it to David, together with his tunic, sword, bow, and belt. David has just finished this huge test in his life, facing Goliath. I mean, this is a big deal. But this wasn't the only test that David was going to be facing. He had some other big tests that were coming. This was just the beginning. God was preparing David to lead the nation of Israel. And God was wanting David to have the right things in place in order for him to be the leader that he needed to be. He had to face some serious pain and some serious trials in his life. And that's what leadership is. I know that doesn't sound like a really encouraging thing about being a leader, but leadership is painful, and they say that when you lead, you bleed. So there are going to be pains, there's going to be problems, there's going to be attacks. And the old saying is, it's not leadership, it's bleedership. And God wanted David to be ready to face all of the different trials he was going to have to face. So he puts this test of Goliath in front of him, and then with all the other trials and all the other tests and all the other preparation that's coming so that David can be the king that God wants him to be, God brings something into his life to help him accomplish that. Now, remember, King Saul is the rightful king. He's been anointed. He's the one who's leading the nation. David has been anointed as the next king, and King Saul now begins to hate David for stealing the hearts of the people. It's almost become a competition in the mind of Saul of looking at David as, man, he's taking everything that should be rightfully mine, and it starts to eat King Saul from the inside out. We even see King Saul trying to kill David on multiple occasions, one time taking a spear and chucking it at him across the room and almost getting David and nearly killing David. King Saul was a very jealous man. So how can David deal with all this pressure? How can he face this test? How can David deal with this new Goliath in his life? Well, God gave David a friend. And there have been many times in my life when I faced what I have felt like were insurmountable problems, difficulties that I just didn't know if I could handle. And every time, God used a friend to encourage me and to help me get through. I'll never forget one day, and it's not been that long ago, when I was driving in my car and driving down the road, and I was down. I was depressed. I was bleeding as a leader and because of some issues that I was facing. And honestly, I was bawling like a baby. I mean, I was crying. I was struggling. And I felt alone, and I felt abandoned by God. Have you ever felt that way? It's okay to feel that way. And I did feel that way, and I was pouring my heart out to God, and I remember asking God, God, are you done with me? Is this everything that you have for me? Is this the whole reason that you put me in the place that you've put me at? Am I just done? Is this the end? And I will never forget, while I was praying, my phone began to ring, and I picked my phone up, and it was a close pastor friend who called, and he said he didn't know why, but he felt very strongly impressed that God wanted him to call and to encourage me. And you know, that really lifted me up. Have you ever had something like that happen to you? When you've been down and God used somebody, a friend, to help encourage you and to lift you up? I mean, think about what David has just experienced here. I mean, the morning of all of this happening in our story, that morning, David comes down, sees Goliath, he goes into battle, and what has already happened with his brothers? Well, they're upset and mad at him, and they kind of attack him, really, just come right out at him and start blasting him. And they even abandon him. They turn their back on him. And then the battle happens, and that evening we see David meet someone who's going to truly define what real friendship is in his life. And that friend that God brought into the life of David is a man named Jonathan. What makes this even more amazing is that most Bible scholars believe that Jonathan was more than twice the age of David. Remember, David's just a young man, teenage years, and he meets this older man, Jonathan, and God puts them together. The relationship should have been Jonathan looking at David more as a son instead of as a best friend, a close friend. But God used this unlikely pair. And think about this too. Jonathan is the son of the man who wants him dead. Jonathan's dad wants to kill David, and God brings these two guys together. I mean, what an unlikely pair. These aren't two people that you would think, oh, they'll be best friends. They're gonna click. They're gonna like each other. It's all gonna work out. Wasn't anything like that. But God gave them a friendship and a relationship like none other. And God wants every one of us to be that kind of a friend to our friends. God gave David a friend named Jonathan. I want us to pray, and we're gonna look at this friendship this morning. Lord, we love you and thank you for your word. I thank you for each person who's watching today. I know they've got so many things that are going on, and they've taken the time out to keep you first in their life, to keep church and to keep your word and to keep you as a priority. And I pray, Lord, that you would bless them because of them. Give them a good day. Keep them safe. Help us to see as we talk about friendship what it is you would have for us to put into application into our life today. We love you, Lord. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, in our story, 1 Samuel 18, verse 1 says, after David had finished talking with Saul, he met Jonathan, the king's son. There was an immediate bond between them, for Jonathan loved David. The first thing I see in the story that just kind of jumps off the page at me is the bond of friendship. I love the word that's used here, bond. That word bond means joined together, knit, or sewn together. It's like two pieces of cloth that get sewn together. And the ESV translation says the soul of Jonathan was knit to the soul of David. At this point, Jonathan's already a proven warrior, a proven soldier. He's a man, grown man. And he's at his father's side, King Saul. He's watching all of the events of Goliath unfold. He's looking at this young man, David, with admiration and respect because he went out when even Jonathan wasn't willing to, when his dad, the king, wasn't willing to. And without even really an exchange of words, God bonded these two together in friendship. What an odd pair, the prince and the shepherd boy. Jonathan is actually the oldest son of King Saul, which makes him the crown prince. So Jonathan was the true heir to the throne. Now he's best friends with the next king. You ever had something like this happen to you where you walk into a room, you meet somebody for the first time, and you instantly knew, I'm going to be friends with this person. We're going to be close friends. At this point in our story, no one could have probably imagined that David was going to need a friend in his life to get through all the things that have happened. I mean, here he is standing with the severed head of Goliath in his hand. Why would he need anybody? He just killed the greatest warrior in all the world. I mean, this guy can handle anything on his own. Why is he going to need this? Well, God knew what David was about to go through. I've had this happen to me. Not where I've held the severed head of anybody or anything like that, but where I've walked into a room and realized that person is going to be my friend. In fact, when my family and I moved here to Kansas City about a year and a half or so ago, and we began to make trips almost 2 years ago in the beginning of the year to Kansas City and to meet people, to look at the church and to pray if this is where God would have us to serve. And I'll never forget one of the places I walked into a room, and there was a man standing there, and we began to talk just very briefly. And as soon as we started talking, I realized, this is going to be my friend. I like this person. We have a lot in common. God just kind of brought us together. So I've had it happen to me, and I thank God for friends and true friendship. None of us know what's coming down the road for us. None of us know what's around the corner. It could be a difficult situation that we're about to face. It could be the loss of a job. It could be the loss of a marriage. It could be a bad doctor's report or an attack from someone. It could even be the loss of a loved one. None of us know what tomorrow holds, especially in the world that we live in right now, where there's so much uncertainty with COVID and with the elections and with all of these things going on. There's so much uncertainty. We all need a friend. We all need someone that we can depend on. We all need good friends in our lives. And I'm kind of tempted to start singing the song, "We all need somebody to lean on," but I'm not going to do that because I don't want to offend your ears of me singing or anything like that. I'll spare you of that. But the world around us is so uncertain, and it's full of people who are selfish. There's a lot of selfish people around in this world. You know how you tell them? They're always alone. They don't have the kind of close friendships that we should have as believers. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 24 says, "There are friends who destroy each other, but a real friend sticks closer than a brother." There's a lot of truth there. A real friend's going to stay with us no matter what. Let's keep going in our story. 1 Samuel 18, verse 2. "From that day on, Saul kept David with him and wouldn't let him return home. And Jonathan made a solemn pact with David because he loved him as he loved himself. Jonathan sealed the pact by taking off his robe and giving it to David, together with his tunic, sword, bow, and belt." In here, I see the second thing that really just jumps off the page at me is the proof of friendship. This wasn't a self-serving friendship. It was a self-sacrificing friendship. How did Jonathan show his friendship to David? He gave him his robe. He gave him his tunic, his sword, his bow, and his belt. This is a giving relationship and not of a taking relationship. Jonathan wasn't looking what he could get from David. He was a giving person. What Jonathan was doing was identifying with David. David just went out and faced Goliath without any weapons except his slingshot and a few stones. And Jonathan, the crown prince, is saying, "I want to be like you. I want to live a life of faith like you, not by force, as we talked about a few weeks ago, not by sword or bow or any other weapon. I want your way. I believe in your way." So he gives David all of his weapons. Jonathan was also giving his royal robe to David. He was symbolically saying, "I love God and I love Israel. And David, you can be the king in my place. You are the rightful king. God has his hand on you. I support you and God, not what I want." He was giving David his claim to the throne. It's no wonder we hold this friendship as a picture of what true friendship really is, an example of it. And to prove the seriousness of this friendship, they enter into a solemn pact in verse 3. It's also translated in other translations as a covenant. And this is a serious thing. Most covenants were sealed by blood. That's how serious they were. So let me ask you, do you have a friend like that? not someone that you've entered into a blood covenant with or anything creepy like that, but do you have a friend that you can count on no matter what comes at either one of you? Someone that you can depend on. God wants us to see in this relationship that when we live a life of faith in Him, as David did, He, that's God, will bring people into our lives to help us as friends. We have to trust God. The third thing that I see that just jumps out in this story at me is the example of their friendship. It's been over 3,000 years since David charged down into that valley with his slingshot going and Goliath standing there, and he whips that thing up like a sniper and hits Goliath and knocks him down, grabs a sword and cuts his head off. 3,000 years have passed and we're still talking about it today. That's how much of an impact there is. We're still talking about a friendship of David and Jonathan so much in the future from when this happened. And the influence of friendship is eternal. It lasts forever. We should want that kind of friendships in our lives. We should want to be that kind of friend to others. And God has given us a serious power and a serious responsibility to encourage each other, to lift each other up. There's enough things in this world that are pulling us down, that are depressing us, that are hurting us, that are attacking us. We need to be the kind of people that lift others up, that encourage one another, that help one another in the face of everything that's happening in our world. Jesus, our ultimate example of this, Luke chapter 15 says this: "Tax collectors and other notorious sinners often came to listen to Jesus teach." What a great place for them to be. "This made the Pharisees and the teachers of the religious law complain." And a lot of times, those are the people that complain the most, is the hardcore Christians who've been Christians forever, the teachers of the law, the folks who grew up in church. They didn't like these people coming near Jesus. These people, these sinners, they're different than us. We don't like it. So they start complaining that he, Jesus, was associating with such awful people and even eating with them. How could he? So verse 3 says, "So Jesus told them this story." And Jesus starts to tell the story of a man with 100 sheep. And they would understand that because shepherding was their main source of income. This was like they understood this. So Jesus tells the story about a man who has 100 sheep and everybody's nodding. Yeah, I get that. Yep. I understand what you're saying. And then this man loses one of his sheep. And he leaves the 99 to go out and find the lost one. And they're all like, "Oh, wow, yeah, I would do the same thing. That's exactly what I would do," because it was their culture. And then he goes into another story about a woman who has 10 silver coins. This was a bridal headdress that would have 10 silver coins in it. And she lost one of them. So what happens when we lose something? Well, we start tearing the house apart, cleaning everything we can, searching between the couch cushions and underneath the bed and trying to find that coin. And she found her one coin. Then Jesus jumps into a third story. I mean, they're already nodding. They understand the sheep. They understand the coins. Yes, that's exactly what I would do. And he goes into this third story about a man who has two sons. And one of the sons has gone off in sin and is lost to the father. But the father never gave up hope on his lost son until he came home again. And they're all nodding, "Yeah, I wouldn't give up hope on my son either." Jesus told them these stories, though, because he wanted them to know that he, Jesus, was their friend. Not just to the religious, but Jesus came to be a friend of sinners as well. He wanted them to make sure that they knew that he, Jesus, came from heaven to seek and to save people. Luke 19:10 says, "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save those who are lost." And Jesus wants us to know that he came to earth and went to Calvary to pay the ransom of our sins. That's right. He came and lived a perfect life, died on the cross to pay the penalty for my sins and to pay the penalty for your sins. That is true friendship. He was willing to seek. He was willing to suffer. And he was willing to die just to save you and just to save me. The Bible says in Romans 5:8, "But God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners." I have a friend, and you have a friend, and his name is Jesus. It reminds me of the old hymn, "What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. Man, what a powerful song and what a powerful thought that we have a friend in Jesus. He's forgiven my sins. He's saved my soul. He's given me a home in heaven, and he's changed my life here on earth. He's done so much for me, and I don't deserve any of it. And he's done so much for you, and you don't deserve it either. And because of what he's done, because of all that he has done for me, I want to be the right kind of friend to others. So let me ask you this morning, do you have that kind of friendships? Well, if you don't, maybe you should look in the mirror and say, am I that kind of a friend? Because it has to start with me. For a man to have friends, he has to show himself friendly. I've got to step out and be the right kind of friend. Live a life of faith, following after God, and God will bring the right kind of people, the right friendships into my life to help me through the difficult times. David's about to experience some unbelievable things that we're going to talk about as we go through his life. And God brought Jonathan into his life to help him to be able to deal with all of the stuff David was about to have to go through. It's nice to have a friend. It's good to have someone you can pick up the phone and say, I just need a friend right now. I'm going through a tough time. Someone who will be there for us. But we need to be that kind of a friend too. Are you that kind of a friend? Because of what Christ has done for me, I should want to be that to everyone else that I come in contact with. Would you pray with me? Lord, I love you and thank you for your word. Thank you for showing us what a true friendship should be. Help us to be the right kind of friend. You know, you're probably watching this today from home or I don't know where you're at. Maybe you're in the car, maybe you're on the boat. I don't know where you're at. I don't know if you're watching this on Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. It doesn't matter when you're watching it. But what I do know is that if you're watching this, you want to have that kind of relationship. And not just with people, but with God. So let me ask you, do you have a right relationship with God? Has there been a time in your life when you put your faith and trust in him to take you to heaven? Let me ask it a little different way. If something was to happen to you today, are you 100% sure you'd go straight to heaven? Well, if you're not, you can be. The Bible's very clear on how. The Bible says the first thing we need to know is we're all sinners. The Bible says, for all have sinned. Every one of us have sinned. And we've come short of the glory of God. We've come short of God's glorious standard. What's God's standard? It's perfection. I'm not perfect. And guess what? Neither are you. None of us are. We've all sinned. We've all messed up. And because of that sin, the Bible says the wages or the penalty for sin is death. And that death is more than just a physical dying. It's a separation from God in a terrible place called hell. And because we sin, that's what we deserve. Just like when we speed down the interstate and we see those lights flashing behind us, we deserve a speeding ticket because of speeding. And because we sin, we deserve the penalty, which is separation from God in hell. But the good news is that verse goes on and says, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. It's a free gift. The free gift of God is salvation. And he offers it freely. He paid the penalty for us. He came to this earth, lived a perfect life, died on the cross, rose again. He paid sin's penalty for me. Just like the verse we read a minute ago in Romans 5:8, but God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. Christ died for me. He paid the penalty. What's the penalty for sins? Death. He paid it so that I wouldn't have to, but I still have to receive it. The Bible says in Romans as well, that whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. That's anybody. Anybody who comes to God for salvation, he will receive. Does that mean you have to get your life cleaned up and be perfect and have all your sin, you know, be all your ducks in a row in order to come to God? No. It means the exact opposite. It means I come to God and he helps me get my life cleaned up. I come to him as a sinner and he's promised he would accept me the way I am if I'll accept him. And when that happens, he comes into my life and begins to help me transform my life, gives me a new life. Has there ever been a time in your life when you have personally prayed and asked Christ for that free gift of salvation? If you've never done that before, you can do it right now. Again, doesn't matter where you are, doesn't matter when you're watching this, you can accept that free gift of salvation. And if you've never done it before, I'll even help you with how to call out to God. We do that through prayer. It's not the words that you say, it's the intent of your heart. So as we pray, if you mean these words in your heart to God, He's promised He would give you eternal life. So right where you're at, no matter where it is, would you just pray with me? And you don't even have to pray out loud because God hears the prayer of our heart. So wherever you're at, would you pray with me right now? Let's do it together. Dear God, go ahead, pray with me. Dear God, I know I'm a sinner. And I know I deserve to go to hell because of my sin. But thank you for dying on the cross and paying the penalty for my sin. And the best way I know how, I accept your free gift of salvation. Thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me, that's the most important decision you can ever make in your life. And I want to be able to pray for you this week. So would you take your phone out and text the word pray to the number that's on your screen right now so that I can pray for you this week. I promise I'll pray for you. I'm not going to show up at your house, bombard you with a bunch of stuff, call you, all these kind of things. No, I just want to pray for you, and that's it. And it never hurts to have a pastor praying for you. So take your phone out. Do it right now, because if you don't do it now, you're going to forget. Take your phone out. Text pray to the number that's on your screen. Christian, how about it? Has there been the time where you've taken the first step following Christ in baptism? Maybe that's what you need to do. Maybe you need to get into a discipleship group, which we have many of those. We've got a discipleship program that we can help you learn more about God, draw closer to Him. Maybe you need to get into a small group. Maybe you need to join the church. We can help you with all those things. Go to our church website, opendoorkc.com, and there's all kinds of information there to help you with your growth in your spiritual life. Or you can do it through our app, our church app. You can go to any mobile device store and download it. All the information's in there to help you grow in your walk with Christ. I hope that you will look for friendships, that you will look for those relationships that God has brought into your life, and be the right kind of friend. We all need a good friend in our life. But more importantly, we need to be a good friend to the people that God has brought into our life. So I hope that you will get in God's Word this week. I hope that you'll look for those people that God has brought into your life, and let's be the right kind of friend. Thank you so much for joining us today. I can't thank you enough. I hope you've enjoyed the service. I hope God spoke to your heart. Let's pray and we'll be finished. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for these folks that have watched this morning online. I pray that you bless them in a special way. We love you, Father. We ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen. God bless you. I love you. I'll see you for devotions every day this week, or I'll look forward to seeing you again next Sunday. God bless you and have a great day. Well, I hope you enjoyed the service today. I hope God spoke to your heart and showed you something that you can do for Him, a next step that you can follow through. We always give some questions that will follow up on the message, some next steps for you to do, and I have them here written down, and I wanted to give them to you before we leave this morning. The first option for you is maybe God spoke to you about asking Him to show you who your true friends are. Maybe that's the step that you need to take, to take some time this week and ask God, Lord, would you show me who are the true friends that you've brought into my life? And spend some time thanking the Lord for those friends. Maybe your next step is to memorize Proverbs 18:24 that we talked about this week. I think it'd be a great verse for every one of us to commit to memory. It'll help us to be the right kind of friend. Or maybe your next step is that you're going to commit to God to be a true friend to those that God's brought into your life. Make that commitment to the Lord. I am going to be the kind of friend God wants me to be, to encourage my friends, to lift them up. In a world that's always pushing us down and discouraging us and hurting us, I want to be the kind of friend that lifts up, that encourages. And pick one of your friends this week that you can reach out to and that you can encourage in a special way. One of those three steps for you to follow through with. Maybe you trusted Christ as your Savior today, and that's awesome. Most important decision you can ever make in your life. We want to rejoice with you. We're excited about that with you. The next step after becoming a Christian, after receiving that free gift of salvation, is to follow the Lord in baptism. And we make it very easy to do here at Open Door. You can go onto our website, www.opendoorkc.com, and you can sign up for baptism there, and we'll talk with you and communicate with you and work that timing out. And we're excited about that. Maybe your next step is to get into one of our small groups. And we've got them going all the time throughout the community, not just here in the building or on the property. Maybe that's the step you need to take, to say, I'm going to get into a group and I'm going to grow spiritually. I'm going to take that next step. Maybe you've been watching or attending Open Door for a while and you've not become a member yet. Well, this is the place for you. We're excited about that. So you can get onto our website and sign up for the next membership class. We just had one this week. We do one every month. We had several people who were in attendance with that and will be signing their membership commitments. But attending the class does not make you a member. It just gives you the information so that you can make that decision for yourself. You can spend some time praying and deciding if this is the place, if Open Door is the place that God would have you to put your life and influence. So whatever the next step is, follow through with it. Again, I want to thank you so much for joining with us today. I hope you have a great week, and I look forward to seeing you this week in devotions and then next Sunday for the worship service. God bless you. Have a great day. I love you. Bye-bye.